as you know, oftentimes it is during these services, during Holy Week, that we experience in the fellowship of the church what I like to call the faithful and the grateful. Those of you who know that these days matter, those of you who may have the tradition of attending church on Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday, and earlier in Lent, on Ash Wednesday. And so, you know why you are here. But I would also dare to say that you are here to say thank you. That you are here to say thank you to a God that has been so kind, so good, and so generous, that it would not feel right, it would not be right, to be somewhere else on Good Friday at 3 p.m. As you know by the witness of Scripture, we know that 3 p.m. is called the hour of mercy. It's the time when we remember. It's the time when we commemorate the death of Jesus. And we do so to consider the severity and the cruelty of sin. Friends, the reality is that the only thing that overcomes such severity and such cruelty is the love of God. And today, we come to contemplate both. Not to diminish the cross, but to consider its meaning. Not to trivialize God's grace, but to strengthen its meaning. Not to diminish the celebration of the resurrected Christ, but to remember the story and the steps that led to the cross and to the resurrection. And so even though it is a day of remembrance, it is also a day for us to contemplate, for us to become aware, for us to be mindful of the cruelty that is in this world, which is only overcome by the abundance of God's love. Friends, I remind you that on Sunday we will worship at 7 a.m., at 10 a.m., our family worship, followed by the Easter egg hunt at 10:30 and the gospel brunch at 11. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we praise you and we thank you today for the abundance of your Spirit in this room. Lord, for you have called us to remember the severity of this day. You call us to consider the weight of sin. And yet at the same time, Lord, we grieve as those who have hope and those who understand the outcomes of your grace and the greater meaning of your glory. And yet, today, at this hour, the hour where your mercy was poured upon the soil of the earth, become brokenhearted, knowing and trusting that by your love and with your Spirit, we shall be comforted in every situation. And so be with us, Lord, as we bring to heart, to mind, to memory, and to spirit this day. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and let the church say,
Amen.
Would you please stand and let us sing together.
Oh, loving God, thank you that we use this Saturday. As the people grieving, as the people standing, staring up as you've broken, God, we also acknowledge that we are guilty, that we put you there. God, we're just so thankful for your love, for your willingness to heal us through your wounds. God, now we come to you with the names of those who are on our hearts to be healed. That we lift up to you, those that are still on our hearts, pray that you would heal them, you would resurrect them, so we know you have the power. Well, now we speak those words that you taught us when you were among us, as we say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As we come to the time in our service where we pass the plate, where we unite our resources to reach out to the world, we ask you, O Lord, that you receive these gifts, that they be found worthy in your sight, and that you multiply them, so that our strength, our love, our spirit may kindle forth in stronger flames, that your kingdom of heaven may come here on earth, that your compassion may pour out like water. And we pray all these things in Christ's mighty name. Amen.
First reading comes from Luke, chapter 23. They also led two other criminals to be executed with Jesus. When they arrived at the place called the Skull, they crucified them, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." They drew lots, his way of dividing up his clothes. I've made the words of each of our mouths, the meditations of all of our hearts, acceptable in your sight as our strength and our redeemer.
Amen.
Well, I gave up news for Lent this year. I used to give up Facebook, but when I started working for the church, I realized that social media is a tool that is essential for keeping up with you in the congregation. So I switched to giving up news. But the happenings of the wider world still creep into my consciousness, mostly through my friends posting about the news on Facebook. Well, this week, it's been about a bridge in Maryland. Not that my Facebook friends are posting news stories or even prayer requests about it. It's mostly conspiracy theories, which is confusing to me. In what fantasy world would anyone benefit from a cargo ship running into a bridge? Why can't it just be an accident? Well, because someone has to be held responsible. Do you remember the barges that ran into the San Jacinto River Bridge in 2019?
Yes.
Twice? Yeah. Someone has to be responsible so it doesn't happen again. I drive over the Fred Hartman Bridge 10 times every week. Do you know how many cargo ships sail under that bridge? Do you know those railroad tracks on 146 near Pinehurst? Well, I can't drive under those railroad tracks if there's a train up there without shivers running down my spine every time. And now, I have to check the ship channel for cargo ships every time I go to work and back. Someone has to be held responsible. Lessons better be learned. Now I realize my chances of being caught in a bridge collapse are almost zero. I'm much more likely to be hurt by one of those crazy drivers on 225 or 146 during shift change traffic. The other day, a lifted F-250, it's always a lifted F-250, was right on my rear bumper. I was going 8 miles an hour, trying not to get run over. And then he whipped into the left lane. I wasn't even in the fast lane. He whipped into the left lane, whipped right back in front of me, cut me off. I said a quick prayer for him. It wasn't, "Father, forgive him." I prayed there was a cop up ahead so he could learn his lesson. Did he mean to do it? It doesn't matter. Ignorance of the law is not an excuse. Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. That's not going to make the freeway safer. I need justice. I work full time in the criminal justice system. Justice is what pays my bills. It's what feeds my family. It's what our country is built on. Love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you. Can you imagine a politician running with that as a campaign slogan? If someone hurts you, forgive them. They might not realize what they're doing. That's not how America works. If we give up on justice, leave vengeance to the Lord, and start forgiving our enemies and loving our neighbors, the country would collapse like the Francis Scott Key Bridge. Our world would never be the same again. But Jesus knows that. In fact, that's what he promises.
read about them in books, where we hear them in operas, there is so much buildup, so much acknowledgement, the dignity given to a human life. But most of the times I have been around suffering and pain and death, it happens almost before people can realize what has come upon us. There is clamor, there is noise, people are speaking, people are talking, people are laughing and going about the daily tasks that they engage in as human beings without realizing that someone is in pain. Someone is crying out. There are many voices in the 23rd chapter of Luke. And Christ speaks many times from the cross. But this is the only time that Christ speaks in direct response to something that's been said to him. Two criminals, one on his right, one on his left. The rulers cry out, "He saved others, why not save himself? Come down off that cross." And the soldiers say, "He says he is a king. If he is king of the Jews, why can't he save himself? Maybe if we put a sign over his head, that will help." And one of the other criminals, someone also being crucified, says, "If you are the Christ, why can't you save yourself and us?" But the other says, "What has he ever done to you? You're not surely teaming up with those who would kill us, are you? Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And there amidst the clamor and the disrespect and the pain and suffering, Christ says, "Let's have church." And says, "Very surely I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. Today it's not we will overcome someday. Today your Savior has been born. Today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. Today this house has been brought to salvation. Today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus calls out. Jesus wants you with him. Every last one of you. All. And it doesn't have anything to do with us. Whether we are the others who are being crucified by the Roman Empire. Whether we are the Roman Empire. Whether we are someone in hiding who does not even dare show their face at this event because they don't really want to be crucified. Not right now. Maybe not ever. Jesus wants you with him. And the King of the Jews calls it paradise. No matter what we are going through, the pain, the loneliness, the fear, the despair, Jesus says, "You will be with me, and I will be with you." Once on the COVID ward, someone had just died, and I found myself holding hands with some of the other nurses, and we began singing, "Abide with me, the evening is coming, Lord of the helpless, stay with us." When other helpers fail and comforts flee, help of the helpless, Lord, abide with me. Today, you will be with me in paradise.
Before I begin what I was asked to do, I want to assure Clayton that the Crosby traffic coming over here was probably as bad as anything you encountered. Just wanted to throw that in. The third word. Can you hear me now? When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that time on, this disciple took her into his home. I don't know about you, but what jumps out at me is the fact that Christ referred to his mother as woman. Older translations of this verse, almost all of them, simply say mother. No, woman. The newer translations often put in dear woman. That's a little shocking. I don't know about you, but I think my mother might have sort of not liked it if I had simply said woman. But I understand that was not terribly unusual in Jesus' time. Now, referring to your mother as woman may have been. But what Jesus is doing here is something that shows his love and his compassion. He is making a formal testimony of transferring his obligation as the eldest son of a widow to his beloved disciple. You see, a woman, as you almost certainly know, in that time was a second-class citizen. She depended upon a male for food, shelter, clothing, protection. Well, he's about to die. You know, last Sunday, during Palm Sunday sermon by Luis, he said Jesus entered Jerusalem knowing that things were going to get bad. Well, they've gotten bad. He's hanging on a cross. But he's still thinking about his mother. And so he wants to make sure she is cared for adequately. And so he turns that responsibility over to this beloved disciple. By the way, Eugene Peterson, in a contemporary English translation of the Bible called The Message, which you might be familiar with, translates the last verse that I read here as, "From that moment, the disciple accepted her as his mother." Well, what can you and I learn today from this word of Christ? Well, we can see that he loved his family. We can see that he may have had some problems with his family at times. You remember back at the wedding in Cana, his mother tells him, "Change that water into wine." And he says, "But it's not my time yet." But then what did he do? He's an obedient son, and he changed the water into wine and all. But also in the third chapter of Mark, it says that his family thought, quote, "He's out of his mind." And in the seventh chapter of John, it says even his brothers did not believe him. But you know, the thing that is probably the hardest for me to accept in this verse is that Jesus is saying we have to honor our parents. We have to honor our parents, no matter what they did. And some of them did some things that are not very nice. Let's be honest. That's hard. That's really hard, I think. Oh, I know. Jesus, first of all, said, "Who do we love?" provide for his relatives, especially for his immediate family. He has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. So I hope you will take away from here the fact that we do have obligations. We have obligations to love God, but we also have that obligation to love our family, to love our father and mother, even though it may be hard, but with God's help, it can be done.
The fourth word of Jesus. At about 3, Jesus cried out with a loud shout, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" I have contemplated that scripture so many times because throughout my life, and probably like many of you, I heard it taught, I heard it preached from the pulpit. But that the 3 hours preceding that, there was darkness of the land. And why was Jesus crying out, "My God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you left me? I've done your will. I've spoken your word. Why have you left me?" Well, when I would hear it taught, God did in fact turn his face away because he could not look on sin. Something didn't sit right with me. It stirred my soul. And so I would pray and pray because Jesus always spoke the word. When he taught and someone questioned him, he would speak in a parable or he would quote scripture. Jesus was the word, and he knew full well his mission. He willingly went to the cross. There were other players in this game, but he willingly, he knew it. He spoke of the prophets, and just true to form, as he's on this cross, agonizing, writhing in pain, he cries out, "Why have you forsaken me?" He was referencing Psalm 22. The psalmist wrote those very words, my God, why have you abandoned me? I've cried out to you. I have prayed. I have lost sleep. I have begged you. You heard others, but you're not hearing me. And now they've pierced my hands and my feet. And they cast lots over my robes, and they mock me. Oh, he cries out to God. Let God save me. Where is God now? It's in Psalm 22. But all those times that he would quote the prophets, he was ignored. He was forsaken by men. He was completely ignored by so many that also said they knew the scripture. So why did he reference this? Maybe he didn't complete that reference because he wasn't at it. Maybe there was no more capacity in his lungs to get any other words out at that moment. Maybe it was to draw attention to those around him to say, "I have spoken these words. Will you hear me now? Will you see that the prophecy is being fulfilled in your very eyes, or are you going to ignore it?" Perhaps he did not finish Psalm 22, because maybe he knew that they would not hear it. He had fallen on deaf ears so many times, as he knew he would. Maybe this was going to be another one of those times. Or maybe, as our Lord and Savior was on this cross for you, for me, for the most wicked of people, maybe he didn't finish Psalm 22 because it goes on to say that he's victorious. And his word goes out from generation to generation amongst the nations. Maybe he didn't finish that because it wasn't complete yet. Maybe because it just wasn't. lost your home, when your family has turned their backs on you, you are not forsaken. Psalm 22 even says, no, you heard me. You did not hide your face from me. So let us be reminded of that mercy and that love, that we are not forsaken. It's not the end of the story yet.
Friends, the truth of the gospel speaks to the humanity and the divinity of Jesus Christ. It speaks to the reality of the flesh, the struggles that we face, that he faced. But it also speaks to a greater glory. As you read each of these words, there's something about the human agony that becomes represented, that becomes so real, that becomes so palpable that you can almost touch it. And so, in this spiral, in what appears to be a downward journey, in what seems to be the strength of a man named Jesus of Nazareth, son of Mary and Joseph, who hurt in the flesh just like you and I do. The fifth word says, after this, knowing that everything was already complete, in order to fulfill the scripture, Jesus said, I am thirsty. Once again, Jesus brings to heart, to memory, the psalmist, to be more specific, the 21st verse of the 69th Psalm. But in my own humanity, in my own understanding of life, when Jesus says, I am thirsty, when he is offered sour wine, what does it mean to be thirsty? There is the agony of the flesh. There is the need for water. There is the desperation of the body as it becomes dehydrated on its way to death. And there is that thirst. But what I also hear Jesus speaking through the echoes of the century is that I thirst for a friend who would comfort me. I thirst for a people who would support me and encourage me. I thirst for a word that would release me from the agony that I am feeling. I thirst for a moment that will not only parch the agony of my tongue, but the void in my heart. Because friends, it is in the fullness of Jesus Christ that we find the unity of humanity and divinity. And it is because Christ says, I thirst, that I know he knows my longings. It is because Christ says, I thirst, that I know he knows my sorrows. It is because Christ says, I thirst, that I know he understands what I feel when I don't feel all right. And friends, the truth of our own lives is that I would venture to say that none of us in this room will ever experience the thirst of crucifixion. And I pray that none of us in this room will experience the thirst of agony in such a way of being executed. Because I remind you, Jesus not only died, he was killed. And even though we may not feel such deep a sorrow in our own flesh, we serve a God who is so kind, so loving, and so full of love for God's own creation, that in the fullness of Christ, Jesus thirsts. Because we thirst.
The sixth word, crying out in a loud voice, Jesus said, Father, into your hands I entrust my life. After he had said this, he breathed for the last time. Growing up, Jesus had knowledge beyond his years. God had his hand on it. There was a God the Father and Jesus the Son relationship throughout his life. God had given Jesus the knowledge to complete the task and fulfill the prophecies as stated in the Hebrew Bible. Jesus had an earthly assignment. God had his hand on it. The job assignment is dangerous, but necessary. Jesus is in control of his whole life. As stated in John, just as the Father knows me, I know the Father. This is why the Father loves me. I give up my life so that I can take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I give it up. And I have the right to take it up again. I received this commandment from my Father. How do you know when it is time to move on to another project, another job, or another life? Have you completed all the tasks assigned to you? How do you know when it is your time to let go and give it all to God? Whatever your problems, and we all have some, put them into God's hands. We all have a book of life with many chapters. Jesus knew the contents of his book of life from the first letter of the first sentence to the period at the end of the last page. He had to live it out, knowing what would happen in the end. Jesus had fulfilled the prophecies told in the Hebrew Bible. Seed of a woman, check. Son of God, check. Sent by Father God to speak his word, check. Perform miracles, check. Teaching parables, what about doing good for others? Check and check. Betrayed, check. Scourged, beat with a whip to the point of flesh falling off. Mocked and ridiculed by the soldiers, check. Prayed with his enemies, yes. Stripped of his clothing, yes. His garments were divided by the soldiers drawing lots. His hands and feet were pierced, forsaken. Thirsty and given vinegar, check. Not on the list of tasks, but something important that happened, There was a supernatural darkness in the sky for 3 hours, and then God, who had his hands on it, tore the temple curtain into two. Jesus knew he was suffering this crucifixion for a purpose. The story in his book of life was nearing the final chapter. It was already written. God had a hand on it. Jesus had to follow it through to the very end. Jesus was still in control of things. He prayed alone. He had been arrested, tried by the Sanhedrin, tried by Pilate, sentenced, persecuted, whipped, given a crown of thorns. He carried the cross until Simon took over the weight of the cross for the rest of the journey. Jesus spoke to the women, was stripped of his clothes, and then his hands and feet were nailed to the cross. He spoke to criminals on both sides and entrusted the care of his mother Mary to John, and then he hung there with his back against the wood, with extreme thirst and the heat of the day for hours. Jesus said, "I thirst," but was only given vinegar, which is a drying agent, to the mouth and throat, making it difficult to speak and even more difficult to project the voice. Jesus was in control of his whole life the entire time. He had reached his limit. It was time to let go and let God take over. Jesus' own human spirit was to be returned to the presence of God the Father. "No one takes my life from me, but I give it up because I want to. I have the right to give it up." Jesus committed himself back to God. In Psalm, it said, "I entrust my spirit into your hands. You, Lord, God of faithfulness, you have saved me." And in the end, Jesus, crying out in a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I entrust my life." After he had said this, he breathed for the last time.
Last word. When he had received the sour wine, Jesus said, "It is completed." Bowing his head, he gave up his life. Jesus said, "It is completed." Jesus said, "It is done." Jesus said, "It is accomplished." What is complete? What has been done and what has been accomplished, Jesus? If the purpose is for the Christ to die, and that is the sole end of the story, if the meaning of the crucifixion is simply death, if the ending picture of the dying Savior is the agony of humanity, then not much has been accomplished. Because friends, I hate to break it to you, but you can turn on the news and you don't have to transport yourself to 2,000 years ago in order to see suffering. It's there. We have almost turned it into entertainment. And yet Jesus says, "It is accomplished." What is accomplished? "I am the way, the truth, the life." That that's what's accomplished. I am the good shepherd, and I know my flock. That's what becomes accomplished. I am the bread of life, and those who come to me shall not hunger. That's what's accomplished. Behold, for I am alive forevermore. That's what becomes accomplished. What becomes accomplished is that the head of evil is struck down, the gates of hell are crushed, and the gates of heaven swing wide open for all of God's people to enter in and experience the joy and the glory and the strength of Christ right now. That's what becomes accomplished. The fullness of love, the overflow of grace, the abundance of power, the beginning of all healing, the new renewed order of creation. All of that for all of us. All means all. Is accomplished. That God walked through the agony of death and through the cruelty of men to break open the abundance of grace. Friends, that's the kind of God we serve, and that's the kind of love that has been given. The salvation of all creation, of all humankind, that's what Christ accomplished. Would you stand and let us sing together?
Oh,
invite us to leave in silence, in honor and remembrance of the significance of this day. But know and rest assured that by the grace of God, by the love vested in Christ, all have been saved.